It's time for match two here at DreamHack Bucharest PGL Tavantale 2016 with me, Nimsh, and Raven, so the same squad as in the previous match. Hey guys.
Yeah, hello. Hey, Lofar.
How are you doing?
I'm doing good, thanks. How are you?
I'm good. Good. Okay, so the intro is done. Now we have the second match, which will be between Orange and Hoi. It's the first time we'll actually have Orange on stream, so we didn't see his decks yet. And I'm quite curious, what is his ban strategy? What are those decks that he was actually cruising through the group yesterday? Yeah. I know that he crushed Tice, I think, 3-0 with Shaman. So we know that he is a capable Shaman player. But Hoi did the same twice yesterday with Druid, 6-0, right?
Yeah, it was crazy. It was really awesome last couple of sets to finish the game. And yeah, just as I mentioned earlier at the start of the day, but Hoi's like improvement with the deck from one set to another was actually pretty huge. So I think today it'll be even better. So continue to improve there. But it's going to be a tough one with Orange because he actually won his WESG qualifier, I think, yesterday.
Yes.
As well. So he's going to be representing Sweden. So he's had a pretty strong day yesterday of Hearthstone and I expect nothing less today as well. So
correct. And now we have also the ban phase on screen as well. Warrior and Shaman banned. Orange was banning the Warrior and Hoi was banning the Shaman. First picks are Druid for Hoi. No surprise here. Like after the super strong performance yesterday, he would have to pick the Druid again if he would be allowed. And it seems like Orange, well, he's not afraid of the Druid. So he left it out and in the open and he picked a Warlock himself. What do you think about the Warlock pick?
Well, the thing is like the guys knows their decks because the lists are public for them, at least that they were released. So banning their Warrior, the Warrior from Hoi, I believe, was the Control Warrior. And the Shaman, you've mentioned yourself, Lothar, that we know that Orange was really successful with the Shaman yesterday. This is the Midian Shaman, I believe. That's why the ban from Hoi's perspective. And the Warlock, like both players are playing Zoo with Discord elements. And I believe here Orange just thinks that Warlock is a deck that can actually win versus Druid. He was, suspecting that the Druid is going to be picked. So maybe he feels like this is going to work. Historically, in the previous metagame, Warlock was one of the decks. Like Zoo was one of the decks to beat the Druid, the midrange one. And right now, Druid doesn't have the Violet Teacher. Both of them are playing the Malagos version. So maybe Zoo is the deck to win versus Druid specifically.
But at the same time, Druid has no more removal, right? Has more instant answers to the minions that are being played on board. And that was the thing that he was lacking in the previous version, because he was always like behind on board and on mercy of POs, mercy on of abusive surgeons and trading up with small minions, and might be different now with you know more access to spell power as well. So we'll see. I'm really curious how this will pan out, and I'm especially curious about the builds from Warlocks, the Discord Warlocks, because I have my own preference, which is like the straight out aggro. Because I feel like when you low roll on the Discord, you lose anyway, and cards like Imgang Boss and Councilman are just too slow for the deck to be to rely on any form of board control, so you just want to dish out damage and end the turn on turn 5. And would love to see that type of Warlock here.
Yeah, definitely. Warlock will be interesting. And we actually talked to Orange about his deck. So let's see if he has something to say about the Warlock specifically.
My name is John Westberg. I'm 22 years old and I'm from Sweden. I just got through from my group as the first place seed, so feeling pretty good right now. This tournament, and especially the format, is amazing. It's very similar to VIA game that was held last year. We had three VIA games, I think, and just using the 9-deck format, especially right now when some classes are just way stronger than others, I really enjoy to be able to play some of the a little bit weaker classes in this tournament. My two opponents this tournament so far have been Tice and Stanislav Sivka, two people that I mean, Tice is probably just the best player in the world, and Sivka I've played against several times this year and haven't had much success. He's been winning the majority of the times we've faced each other. But I managed to win against both of them today. I obviously feel great about that. When it comes to decks, it was mostly the decks that I expected people to bring. But Sivka in particular had some interesting tech cards in his decks that really switched matchups that I thought were in my favor, but then Sivka just showed that he had built his decks in some ways that I wasn't fair at all, but I still managed to close out the series somehow. It's really interesting how this format, how much you can many extra edges you can gain in deck building, I think. This tournament is so stacked, so like almost everyone that you are gonna play against are just gonna be like top level, some of the best players in the world. I guess for like personal reasons, I know I haven't got to play against Crane, and he just advanced as the winner in his group, and I would like to play a high level match versus him because I don't think I've ever done that, actually. I prepared a lot for this event. I really hope that I can close it out and win it. My latest tournaments, I haven't had very good results, so it would be really good for me if I could win this one. But in this field, it's not going to be easy. Not really. Good luck and have fun, I suppose.
Okay, so that was an interview with Orange, and I really like what our playing, what the players are saying, because everyone is like, I like the format.
Yep.
I think it's complicated. I think it. It engages the players more, and they have a lot of room to wiggle when it comes to deck building, right? So it's super like enjoyable for everyone.
Yeah, I think that's one of the standout things we've seen over the last, like yesterday and a bit this morning, is that these are not just decks you're going to take on ladder, or at least most of them aren't, mm-hmm. right? You know, we've seen life coaches or G2s, I guess, variant on Rogue, which is just more anti-aggro, like Rogue with no gadgets and feels just wrong, but in a, you know, a sort of targeted format. You can make it work. We've seen an Azoth style of Hunter from JJ, for example. So it's really cool to see sort of maybe even just standard decks, but with like kind of huge tweaks really to make them a little bit off. And he said Orange was there like, oh yeah, I played against Sifka, who had some interesting tech choices. It's like, well, sounds like Sifka.
We'll see that in the match against Life Coach. But now we have the interview of the second player, which is Hoi. So let's see what he has to say.
Hey, my name is Fredrik Hoi Nielsen, and I play for Na'Vi. It's a very special format because there's like four really, really good classes at the moment: Warlock, Warrior, Druid, and Shaman. And you can only play one of them, kinda, depending on your opponent's ban, because there's three, there's one ban, one pick, and then two bans. So it's a way different meta compared to normally Conquest Best of Five or Last Hero Standing, so it's very exciting. In my first series, I played against DK Wonder from Escort Gaming. And I was really, really confident when I went into the series because I had some good classes to counter his classes. But then we played the Voyeur Mirror, and he plays Yogg Voyeur, and he played Yogg, and he got the Naturalize, and I played another Control Insert Voyeur, so he made me draw cards, and in the Control Voyeur Mirror, we were able to draw cards, so I lost that game. So I hate Yogg. I've played against Orange a lot of times. Like, I normally face him in top 8 or top 16s. Like, the last two DreamHacks, I faced him in top 8 or top 16. He's a really, really good player, and I respect him a lot. So I think it's going to be a really, really close series. You always hope to win when you go into a tournament, but it's like, you know, there are some variants in the game. So the most important thing for me is to do the best and like look over the games and still be satisfied on how I play. And if I played the best as I could, then I will still be happy, even though if I lose. I would like to face 6-0 in the final. That could be awesome. But there's a lot of good players, than Sifka, Super JJ, some really, really high level players. So it's going to be a really, really tough elimination bracket tomorrow, but I'm really looking forward.
So he's looking to face his teammate in the final. I guess that's the dream for every team, like to have the team final, because it's so much.
It's like almost a
respect,
win-win.
Right?
Yeah.
And then we'd win the situation.
That would be awesome, yeah.
But in general, what do you guys think? Druid or Warlock in this match? Which will be the favorite?
Honestly, I think... like, we've seen a lot of strength from Druid. We haven't seen that strength from Warlock yet, but I would give it to Warlock because I feel like Warlock can be super fast, really explosive. I played the deck a bit. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you do miss the 50-50s with Silverware Golem, but most of the time, you with the Imp, playing a Doomguard during the cards, you have a constant flow of damage and advantage. So I would give it to Warlock.
Yeah, but it seems like we'll be unfortunately not seeing the Warlock in game one, but hopefully in next ones. So we'll see how that goes. It seems like the opener will be Druid versus Mage. And this is the first time we are seeing Orange's decks on the stream. So have fun, guys. Take it away.
Thank you so much, Lothar. All right, so Druid versus Tempo Mage. This is something that we haven't seen that often, I believe, in the previous meta games.
No, so, well, you know, going back a few months, Tempo Mage was actually one of the better decks to play versus Druid because it was still back in the day when Mad Scientist was a card and you were playing cards like Mirror Entity, which causes a huge problem for Druid, as we know. But things are a little bit different now. And the Druid is, you know, we've been harping on about how extremely powerful it is. Hoi's just come off the back of last night 6-0 with this deck. But I think Tempo Mage can punish it, because sometimes Tempo Mage is just too fast.
Especially because...
that's the point of the deck, right? So sometimes it just goes too fast for Druid to keep up with. But we did see Kabbalah's Tome in hand there, so this is a variant that might have been knocking around recently. Again, not sure exactly of every card in Orange's list, but there's a list with Kabbalah's Tome with Antonidas as well, so you can actually battle the late game against decks like Control Warrior and even Druid.
I can confirm from memory, I had a look at his list just a moment ago. He does have Antonidas in this Tempo Mage for sure. So overall, looking at the hands, you've mentioned how Mage looks like. It looks all right, especially versus Druid with no normal taunts. Like maybe the Ancient of War is there, but Druid of the Claw is not being played. So there is ramp for Hoi, and that's important. There is Wild Growth, there is Coin, there is Innervate, he has the Wrath to be able to respond to those early minions. So for now, I think it definitely looks okay for Hoi.
Yeah, I mean, he has like the two options of ramp, right? Because he can coin into Wild Growth this turn, which will allow him to potentially innovate out the Azure Drake to just try and get ahead on board. But that's going to be, you know, dependent on what Orange's response is to this Wild Growth. As if we see that the Apprentice does come down, then, you know, your Azure Drake isn't really safe. But the good thing here is he's not like forced into that line of play with the Innovate and the Azure Drake. He can actually just, he has the Wrath as like the backup to just kill off, you know, a card like Apprentice or the Cult Sorcerer. That's
the Cult Sorcerer, yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, both of them are the two drop threats from Mage predominantly. So, and both of them are pretty high priority kills as well, because when you have the Cult Sorcerer, you have Arcane Blast that can just decimate most of the early minions from Druid. And then obviously Sorcerer's Apprentice, you can whip in so many extra spells in the turn because of the reduction. So
there is one card I'm really excited to see, though, for Tempo Mage. It's a Bubbling Book.
Yeah, it's a cool card, isn't it? I kind of like it, but I feel like it definitely suits better in this version where you are playing Tomes as well, because you're saying, like, you know, you have all the normal Tempo Mage toolkit of just winning the game in a few turns, depending on how your opening hand goes out. With the Mana Worms, we can see Sorcerer's Apprentice, and Flame Waker, of course, is quite an aggressive card in itself, but it does have the ability to go quite late with the Tomes, and we might even see that because, as we've seen from Druid so far, that it can go very late with double Feral Rage, for example, and just the heavy removal it can have if it gets off the Wrath, the swipes, so on.
Yeah, certainly. So here, what do you take? Claw, Mark of Nature, Soul of the Forest. Claw will be... with Claw, you are actually able to deal with the 3-2, mostly the 3-2, if you don't want to use the Wrath.
Yeah. It's a tough one, actually, because Claw is pretty decent versus Tempo Mage. You can just get the extra damage on there and kill off a lot of the minions. But also, like, Mark of Nature is like the value pick overall. But at this moment in time, Claw is way more valuable. And even looking at Hoi's hand, Mark of Nature isn't going to get played for a while yet. There are no even tokens on the board. There are no minions, really. There's a follow-up of Azure Drake a bit later on. And the Arcane Giant's too far away to be played anytime now. So I do like the Claw here. Just save the Wrath if the Mana Worm grows with spells this turn.
I do agree with that as well. And Soul of the Forest was not really a decision there, because it will be hard to have a board against this Mage. Plus, this is a different deck. This is not the Violet Teacher anymore.
Exactly,
so Soul of the Forest has less value.
Yeah, when everyone's playing the Violet Teacher list before Karazhan, Soul of the Forest was actually a card in the deck sometimes, because you just get the value from all the tokens. But as you said, quite rightly, the Violet Teacher isn't in this list, so that is almost not even considered in this matchup specifically.
All right, so here with no minions, still he has that Mana Worm. Would you consider Frostbolting this early, or do you just deal to damage and pass?
I think you're okay just pinging this turn, because I think Frostbolt, if you're against maybe Warrior, you'd consider a Frostbolt to lock out, you know, potential weapon draw. But, you know, the hero power doesn't really do anything to Mana Worm, and you've just seen Claw, which was the pick from Raven Idol, of course, used on the Sorcerer's Apprentice. So how is that extra 2 damage happening in Living Roots? Then you're probably okay with that. If it's hero power Living Roots from Druid on turn 4, like, great. That's almost a victory in itself for the Mage.
Oh, man, this turn is so good for Hoi, just dealing with the board, and Thorisan is not a 4-drop. You can deal with this Azure Drake easily with the Frostbolt and ping, but then on turn 5, Kabbalah's Tome. So, game is definitely not over yet. There are still some options for both players. Just dealing with the Azure Drake is a necessity.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's pretty straightforward. Frostbolt, ping here, nothing too fancy. But the key here for Orange is next turn he can Tome. And then that opens up like way more options for him to, you know, work out how he wants to progress forward with this game. Because he can Tome and then into Emperor, which is part of, you know, Emperor's another pick in this deck that's slightly new of this new style. You have Emperor, Antonidas, and Tomes, and Babbling Books. So you have so many resources that you generate, and then combined with Emperor, you make everything that you get from these sort of random spell-giving cards cheaper.
You can actually fight for value instead of tempo. So
well, this deck, which is this Tempo Mage deck, can like just legitimately beat out a long game in Control Warrior.
So when do we stop calling it Tempo Mage?
Never. Never.
It's just whenever you see a Flame Waker, it's a Tempo
exactly.
Mage.
Exactly. Flame Waker, Mana Worm, Tempo Mage.
Makes sense.
But the problem with that is, in all seriousness, is if you start calling it something else, like, it's very, when you just change a few cards in the deck, does it completely change the archetype? Probably not.
Well, it might if it changes how you play the deck, but on the other hand, you still have those big tempo swing turns with the Flame Waker and coins. But still, he is missing those cards. Fandral, though, is a nice pickup for Hoi that he's able to play it. He was still considering it because Fandral is so good overall as a card. But now, will Orange just kill it? Because it's Fandral. If there is Nourish being played after this, it gives crystals, it draws the cards. Fandral can get out of control pretty fast.
Yeah, this is kind of frustrating, actually, for Orange. He would have really liked to just get off a very easy Tome this turn. But obviously, Hoi has something to say about that with that Fandral draw. But I think you have to kill it. Whenever you leave Fandral alive, like, what if Nourish comes out next turn? Like, you're in mega trouble.
But still, let's look at the deck from the Malaga's perspective, because I feel like we still have this mixed up with the Violet Teacher one. So there's no Power of the Wild anymore. So what is the worst possible scenario? You've mentioned Nourish. What else? If you go for Tome, Wrath doesn't matter. Feral Rage doesn't matter that much, because...
Yeah, Feral Rage face isn't really... I think the key one is just Nourish, to be honest.
Yeah,
so or even Raven Idol.
Raven Idol is very important as well. Yeah, I think like...
Speaking of which...
So that was a
it's like I can summon a card with my name on it. It's kind of cool.
It does work. It does work. And in the beginning, Raven Idol was not playable, really. Like, people just ignored it when it got released.
Yeah, I think just because Druid was focused in a different direction at that point, whereas the combination of Yogg and now Arcane Giants, I'm just trying to get the value game for Druid a lot of the time, actually just makes Raven Idol incredibly powerful and flexible.
And Fandral itself also makes the card much better.
Exactly. And the key to Druid at the moment, or like this variant at least, is something I really enjoy about the deck is that there's so many like decisions you have to make at every single point. You have the choose ones to decide on, even like the Nourish decision of whether to ramp or draw. Like there's so and the second you kind of mess up one, you can actually just screw up the whole game.
And the flexibility as well that those choose cards provide.
It's just going to match Emperor with a Golden Emperor. So pretty sure Hoi should win that fight, just because his is shiny and the other one isn't.
He had an opportunity to kill the Emperor, but this is so many resources that he just wants to engage in the trading, right? He wants Hoi to trade his Emperor into the Emperor.
Because the problem is as well, if you can't get on the board versus Druid and you're always on the back foot reacting to their minions, they play a lot of big minions and you're probably not going to be able to keep reacting to them. So Orange there just making the play that can potentially get him ahead in the next few turns. And now he has suddenly 4 mana Tome, you know, 1 mana Frostbolt and the 3 Arcane Blast feels a lot nicer to deal with going forward.
Hey, Yogg-Saron on 9 is also fine, especially because this hand doesn't represent that much. Like, this hand is not a winning hand from Orange, where Hoi is in a pretty good spot here.
This is really nice, though, because of the Wrath being discounted, he can actually just clear because he's drawn into this Living Root. So.
And drink a card as well. So. Yeah. Pretty good decision there. He was able to go for the Arcane Giant, but instead he just wanted to keep Thorazin healthy instead of trading.
Okay. Looks like Tome to me, Nimsh.
Yeah, I think we have to. There's nothing else.
I mean, he can cast the rest of his hand minus Yogg, so why not Tome this turn?
There is a
way
to clear if you have perfect missiles. Can you have like missiles first, and then if no missiles go to face, you can still finish it off? Probably not.
Yeah, I don't think like relying on the ping to need to happen is worth not playing the Tome this turn. Look at that, not bad.
That might be not bad, but it doesn't solve the problem, which is you still have to kill Thorazin.
I mean, he can polymorph Arcane Blast. That'll deal with Thorazin. Or he can still just Frostbolt Arcane Blast. There's a lot of options, and he does have Flame Lance later on for the big guys. So the Flame Lance is actually pretty important. at this point because he could just straight up kill an Arcane Giant, which is pretty nice for even, you know, 5 mana deal 8 damage only to a minion.
And because
not the best card in the world, but as a reactive card for almost free in the deck because of Tome, works out pretty well.
The Arcane Giant you mentioned, because of that, I'll also keep the Polymorph. So I like the decision of Frostbolting there and doing the Arcane Blast instead.
Yeah, I mean, just going to say, Polymorph deals pretty well with Malygos as well. If you're planning on not dying the turn Malygos is played. So Polymorph, definitely the more flexible of the cards, even though he did have to use 2 cards versus... he would have had to use the Arcane Blast anyway, so he swapped the Frostbolt for the Polymorph, which definitely feels good.
Yeah, makes sense. And here, probably going for the Giant to just bait out the possible removal and before Malygos.
Well, you're not even really expecting too much removal in this deck, right? The deck doesn't normally just run like hard removal. You just... If he has something from Tome, fine. You can't really deal with it, and you definitely just play out your hand and go as wide as possible. Because now, with the other minions on the board, a Flame Strike clears up the 3, but then leaves the Arcane Giant up. Or a removal on Arcane Giant more than likely leaves at least 2 of the 3 other minions up as well.
The thing is, there is ninja removal. So if there are Tomes, if there are Bubbling Books, you will get some removal, possibly. Like,
yeah.
And Mage has a lot of removal overall in the arsenal. Not only the Flame ones, but you can get Polymorphs, you can get Shatter. So there's like a lot of stuff you can actually get with the board. Plus, eventually, you do have the Yogg-Saron. So for now, it looks like Hoi is in a good position because he still has minions on the board. But that Yogg-Saron can change the game quite fast. And Hoi is also running out of cards where Orange has Arcane Intellect.
Yeah, I mean, Hoi can actually cycle with the Wrath as well, just to help out a little bit.
Ooh. That's a nice cycle.
Yeah.
Get and 2 cards.
Now Orange will draw. And Spell Power as well, pretty nice. Means he can just tidy up one of the taunts. Nourish as well, one of Hoi's favorite cards, so I'm told. But not playable this turn with only 2 mana. And now you hold on to Living Roots here because you have Malygos Living Roots next turn. I don't think you value using the Living Roots just to cycle a card over actually just killing your opponent next turn based off the board state at the moment.
It's a matter of damage, actually. So if you go for the Roots now, you draw the card and you deal 2 damage instead of just dealing 5 more. Actually, 2 more maybe, because if you go for the Roots on the 0-2, you also have a minion that can actually attack face. So maybe it was worth it to do the Roots. I'm not sure.
Yeah, the only thing is, like, with a Flame Strike this turn, then your follow-up feels pretty terrible. Yeah, yeah, we are going to see the Yogg get played. Innovate, okay.
There is a Dart Trap as well. Fatal Rage giving him
damage. Farsight's pretty huge, actually.
Card draw always good.
Free Arcane Blast, sure.
That's a nice Lava Burst.
Healing only going to benefit Hoi. Okay.
So it was a decent Yogg-Saron.
It's a very good Yogg. He didn't clear the board, but his Yogg survived and his Divine Shield. And he got some mana as well to play around with, so he can go into Blood Mage and actually with the Farsight Arcane Blast on this Azure Drake, so...
Plus...
Looking pretty good.
He has a secret, which we know is a Dart Trap, but Hoi doesn't know what it is, so he will have to play around different secrets. And he doesn't have a good way to deal with this Yogg-Saron here, which is a 10-5 Divine Shield.
Yeah, and the problem is because of that, suddenly the Malygos play this turn isn't good because Malygos just dies.
Yeah.
If you can't kill your opponent easily this turn, Malygos just dies and the Yogg still lives because of the Divine Shield. So that Yogg has pretty much just thrown Hoi's plans completely out the window here.
Well, what you need a Moonfire and you get the Moonfire. So now you have, how much damage is it? This is 13 damage. So you have enough to win the game next turn. With Malygos, you have enough mana to do it, so maybe just try to survive this turn and play Feral Rage.
I think you just Feral Rage, why not, at this point. There's very limited options. You can still Wild Growth, no problem. And because the secret is a Hunter secret, then you're not scared of Counterspell, which would be the real fear, I think, for the Malygos.
Are you scared of anything? Because there is probably no secret that can actually hurt you here.
Wow, second Moonfire.
There's no Hunter secret that can actually stop Hoi from winning this game.
Nope. So even if you played Feral Rage and it's Catrick, there's what, 14, 15, 16 damage. He's still extremely safe with that Feral Rage with armor. So
that will be it, unless Orange can find a way to deal 25 damage this turn.
Yeah.
12 on board. He can Arcane Intellect first, see what's going to happen. Polymorph Boar is a beast, I believe. So that's 5 damage that he can find. Not sure about Azurjake, but on the other hand, do you think you're dead? If you get something like a bubbling book into Ice Block, then you survive and have a chance.
Yeah. That's the problem, isn't it? There's realistically nothing he can draw into that's going to stop him dying. So he's actually just going to just play his best turn and hope for the best. But at this point in the game, we can see that there's Maligos, Moonfire, Living Roots. There's all the damage Hoi could ever want. And it's going to be another win for the Druid.
Yeah, it only shows how strong this Druid is, because it didn't seem that Hoi was doing much. He was just playing cards. They were going 1-for-1. And then suddenly you have that Maligos. You have extra spells, and with Moonfire, a card that was really laughed at for so long, you just finished the game dealing 12 damage to face. Easy.
Yeah, and you know what? That Gadget Zan was pretty key. The draws were looking pretty rough for Hoi at one point, but the Gadget Zan just helped with that extra little bit of cycle and just presenting some form of threat onto the board as well. So Hoi now 7-0 with this Druid. Why is he bothering bringing any other deck?
It is, well, the other icons, told him to.
Yeah, the other icons are just for show. He's only going to play Druid.
Why is nobody banning the Druid? You have to stop banning it at some point of the game. But yeah, Druid just stays there. It's last hero standing, so he will just keep playing Druid. What's left of Orange? What are the classes? So Mage is gone. He cannot play Mage anymore. He has Zoo. So the deck that he picked is the first pick. And the deck that I think has a good chance to deal with that with the Druid. And to just rush it down and kill it before it even draws the good cards. And I don't remember the last class. Do you remember it?
No, is my answer. Okay. I actually can't remember, because we were so focused on the Zoo. You know, when we were discussing when we saw the picks and bans. I mean, I'm sure we'll see in a second anyway. I can't actually remember what it is, but I imagine it is going to be the Zoo into the Druid. It appears to be, as we can just have a quick glance at Hoi's screen there. Oh, it's Hunter. Okay.
No, it's a Zoo.
Yeah, I mean, Orange is third class.
Oh, the third class, yeah, okay. Yeah. So Zoo versus Druid. Let's quickly look at the mulligans. As the Zoo, you definitely keep Malkazar Imp, Malkazar's Imp, and then you are looking for some more standard Zoo cards, like the optimal maybe. Do you want Librarian this early? I guess if you get like the Golem as well.
Yeah, I mean, so I've played a bit of this, or at least, you know, this variant of Zoo, and maybe not the exact list Orange is running, and I'm just not really a fan, to be honest. I feel like you're always trying to make the discard mechanics work, and it forces you into some really weird situations that don't always pay off and can feel a little bit inefficient sometimes. I mean, when it does pay off, like, great, you know, you actually just end up stomping someone. But I feel like it's a little bit risky, so we'll see how it turns out for Orange.
Honestly, Raven, like, no disrespect for you and me, but I just think we just can't play this deck correctly. And
are you trying to say we're just bad at the game?
Not bad at the game, but like, just this deck is difficult to play, and I've seen 6-0 having just amazing score of the deck and doing some super good decisions. And there's a lot of things to when you have to consider when you get this deck for the first time. How to mulligan? Do you keep Librarian? Mm-hmm. How do you go for the discard mechanic? When do you discard? Do you go for 50-50s or do you just keep playing cards when you get 100% value there? So I think there's this is just a different type of Zoo, and people just try to apply the old strategy to the new cards in a way. That's why a lot of people just end up with random 50-50 discards, where 6-0 is just going 15-1 on ladder with the list. So I think like over time, most of the people will learn. I'm not sure if Orange already practiced with the deck enough.
Sounds like you give me an inspirational speech, which is like, in time, you'll be able to play this deck.
Yes, young Padawan, at some point.
Thank you, I appreciate it. I look forward to the day. Okay, so that was a pretty huge turn for Hoi while we were talking there. So he just had Innovate Coin into the Maya Keeper. So did go for the ramp, of course. He has Wild Growth and another Maya Keeper as well. So he has all the ramp he needs to a certain extent, but Hoi needs to make sure that he has some kind of follow-up, right? If Zoo can deal with this, as we're about to see the Soulfire come out now, it's going to see the Imp do its thing, discard the Abusive, and cycle into a 3-drop. Seems pretty reasonable to me.
It's so good. Like, Malkazar's Imp is the card that is definitely needed to make the discard card work. Not even mattering with the Librarian or whatever, the Golem. The fact that you can actually have an Imp, play Doomguard, discard 2, draw 2, and just keep drawing cards without spending your life. You spend your life just having those cards in hand instead of being forced to lifetap into them.
Yeah,
so big.
Well, it's like, if you said to someone who plays card games, like, if I told you could every turn discard a card, draw a card, if even if it's not of your choice, you'd probably do it a lot, almost all the time, because you always do exactly just want to cycle through your deck in almost every time anyway. So the Wrath is drawn from Hoi, so he can deal with this imp if he feels it's enough of a threat.
Well, it's only two power for now. Obviously, there is the threat of discard draw mechanic that's still available to Orange. But I believe you do need the ramp. You need to get as much mana as possible because you don't have Violet Teacher anymore. You need to get to Ancient of War. You need to play Arcane Golems to be able to... Arcane Giants to be able to battle this board.
I actually... Councilman is insane here. So Councilman is so good versus Druid. There's just no good way to deal with this minion, right? Good way at all. Like, in earlier versions, it used to just draw out mulches. But now there's no mulch being played in the current list, at least. So... The Councilman is just going to cause a huge problem, even though the Zoo list more than likely doesn't run Forbidden Ritual to really, go crazy in one turn with Councilman. It just doesn't matter. It's a 1/5 that's guaranteed going to grow because the Zoo deck is so heavy on minions. Probably plays, two spells, potentially, if it's just Soulfires?
Yeah, you might be right.
And maybe Power Overwhelming, maybe, sure. but definitely two Soulfires. And the rest is minions.
That Councilman is actually played in this list because some people just started cutting it for Golem or some other things. But
yeah, I mean, when I gave the list a go, I tried cutting Councilman and then instantly put it back in. I was like, no, this card just on its own is too good.
Just have to have it.
Considering, as I said, the Zoo deck predominantly just plays a full deck of minions, you're always going to be able to buff it going forward.
And most of the time, you do control the early game. So Councilman is bad when you play it and your opponent has a full board of creatures. But most of the time, you just have one minion at least, and you can play Councilman.
Yeah, 5 health on the 3-drop. So good. Pretty good. So now we go into
double imp.
Turn.
You can go double imp even and trade Councilman into the 3/3 and go face with the rest, and you have a really good board.
How bothered are you about trading, though?
Do you want to lose a minion?
Do you care about your Voidwalker dead? Because that's on the board now, that's all that really happens. And if you trade, you open up the Councilman to removal. The point or the strength of Councilman at the moment is 5 health. If you make that any lower, Swipe kills it. A Wrath will kill it if it trades into the 3/3. I like just going aggressive here.
Well, Swipe still kills it if you just go face and don't kill the 3/3 because 3/3 goes into the 1/3 and then Swipe and Hero Power kills the Councilman.
Ah, yeah, but that's the whole turn. And then Swipe does nothing else versus the rest of the board. So I would be okay with that. If that was the play next turn from Hoi, I'd be fine. Because you still have the rest of the board and you can just tap into whatever next turn and carry on. So I like just getting aggressive here. We'll see what Orange thinks though, and he agrees.
Orange agrees with you. I would be fine with trading, but both plays are definitely okay here because he has an advantage and Hoi is in desperate need of some kind of AoE. Raven Idol can provide that, but on the other hand, you do have the Gadgetzan as well, and if you play Gadgetzan and Raven Idol, you will be able to cycle some cards. And Gadgetzan is a target that your opponent wants to kill.
Yeah, the thing here as well is he can actually kill off the Councilman this turn if he wants to use Wrath and Moonfire and Hero Power as well, but that is a lot of resources. And if you play Gadgetzan this turn, I'm pretty sure Orange can just choose to ignore it because it's not like the Rogue deck. Where you can cycle a ton of cards in a turn more than likely. Like, Druid normally gets 2 to 3, on average, I guess, at this point. And also, next turn, there's just not that many cards available if the Gadgetzan isn't played either. So, I don't know, I think you have to start removing these minions and kill that Councilman because there's going to be more minion follow-up.
Oh, definitely. And the Bite is a very nice pickup because you can Wrath Councilman for 1 and then Bite it as well. Unless you want to Wrath a 3/2 and fire it.
You may as well. You have Auction in Moonfire next turn to cycle, or to start cycling at least. So you may as well use Wrath to, or save Wrath to be able to kill off a higher priority target later on.
Another Soulfire that will work with Malkazar's Imp.
Only if he doesn't play Knife Juggler or taps. Because you need to actually discard a card.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah, this is one of those weird situations again that you have to try and manage as playing this new Zoo list where you need to work out how valuable the cycle is versus the card is in your hand. And a lot of the time, that's actually very difficult to do.
But it's actually great that you have an option now.
Yeah, that's true.
You can make that decision. Do I want to
sometimes
cycle or
tap in last is correct.
It might be.
That's what's the best thing about this deck.
So juggler and villager is also not bad. But on the other hand, juggler, soulfire, discard villager, draw a card is cool. Villager is not that potent at this current situation because we are getting to the late game. Ancient of War might happen. Arcane Giant might happen.
Yeah, I mean, do you even need to play Soulfire this turn, though? I think you're feeling pretty good. You've got a lot of options here. Worst case is we've seen that the juggle misses. And then he has to trade the Gangbus in, which makes the swipe a little bit stronger. But overall, with the Possessed Villager as well, swipe isn't really going to completely ruin your day. And you kind of want to save Soulfire to either kill off a bigger minion or actually just end the game for you and go face.
And you haven't seen swipe last turn.
Yeah.
Where swipe should be fine last turn, I guess. All right, so Gadget Sun is live. You can Rav, you can Moonfire, you can draw two cards. So that's something for sure.
Yeah, the frustration with Moonfire is like, it doesn't really do anything, does it? You can kill off either a 1-1 or proc Death Rattles or, you know, the Imp Gang Boss, but then the damage you lose or you save from the Imp Gang Boss dying just comes back in the juggle anyway, so. Kind of awkward. I mean, you might just have to Moonfire anyway just to cycle because there's not a lot of options. It just doesn't ever feel too great. Unless he wants to Moonfire Wrath for one.
Yeah, Wrath for one and then draw more cards even.
I just feel like Wrath in the Flame Imp is going to be a priority here because it's just a lot of damage. You're only on 18. We'll see what he draws first, though. Moonglade Portal is definitely going
to
help.
Also, if he gets an Innervate, he'll be able to Hero Power as well.
That's true. He's going to go for the cycle, though. Probably deciding that he just needs to draw as many cards as possible to give him some form of out, and hey-ho, Yogg-Saron is definitely an out in any game.
And how much damage do we have right now? This is 4 plus 4, 8, 12. If he gets a PO from Peddler, then that will be enough. So Peddler first.
Is still, it that's only 16, right?
With the peddler, with PO should be enough. I think it's like 8 on board, 4 in hand, 12. Oh yeah, 16.
That's 16.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So he did get the seeker though. So just get to fill the board up and just casually drop a 1-mana 5/5. Why not? See now, do you Soulfire tap or tap Soulfire?
That's the good. That's a good question. You definitely Soulfire the Gadget Sun.
Yeah.
But not sure. Tap last was the correct play here. What?
Yeah, I think the idea here is the tap at this point means that you would only have one mana. So if unless you actually tapped into a one drop that you couldn't play anyway, then what if he taps into Doomguard? That's the issue.
Exactly.
Right?
You so just don't want to discard randomly.
Exactly.
And you definitely want to Soulfire the Gadget Sun.
Exactly. You cash it on the Soulfire now. If we drew Doomguard, that, you know, don't get us wrong, Orange is in a good position here. But if you discard Doomguard when you just didn't need to, when you're already ahead, like, why take the risk?
So can Hoi survive and play Yogg-Saron next turn? If he heals for 6, is it right? Or is it 5?
Yeah, he can survive, actually, I think.
It's 5, so 15.
It's 6.
6? Right?
Yeah. Heal for 6, and then create a 6 drop.
Okay. And with the Wrath, you can kill the 3-2?
Yeah.
There's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, plus 3,
do you
want to
kill the 3-2? Because if you make... Oh, you can make room on the board anyway, I guess. Yeah, okay, so you do. I was thinking that... I was forgetting about the minion from the portal, but... because the board's full, then you don't give an option for Doomguard, right? But now with like a 1-1 token on the board, you can just trade the token and play Doomguard.
Yeah, exactly. So
it doesn't matter too much. I think you may as well just Wrath at this point.
And that's another spell for Yogg-Saron
exactly,
that you probably want.
That golden animation's pretty cool on the 7-6. What's that card called, Nimsh?
Skaram Cultist.
Nice. Okay, I knew you'd get it.
Alright, so we need some more damage here. Is plus 2 damage enough? This
nope.
is 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Well, the imp wasn't
13.
Enough. So the plus 2 won't be.
But you can still tap.
You can.
You can still tap, and you need plus 1 or 3 damage from one source. So if you get Doomguard, you win. If you get PO, you win. If you get another wolf, you actually win. No, you will not have enough space. Dark Peddler can win this game. Fine. Even
he'll be one off if he gets PO, right?
No, PO should be fine. Because he needed one damage. So he will not play Direwolf, just PO, I believe. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11,
oh.
12.
Yeah, it's exact.
Yeah, with PO, it's like so. Still, my math is off today. I don't
it's
trust
fine.
Myself anymore.
It's fine. We'll do the slow counting if we need to. It's not a problem. But yeah, Pierre would have ended it there, but didn't get it. Got another Seeker, though, so dropping another the second so one mana 5/5 of the game.
We are going to see Yogg-Saron from Hoi. Yeah. He lived enough, long enough, to be able to play it. And it will really depend on like, what's his health total, but I've seen this matchup many times before, and the Yogg-Saron can flip it. So let's see.
Yeah, there are death rattles on the board and the imp as well. So, you know, there's a chance that something gets left over here, even through like a big AoE Berkeley.
Well, there's a chance that everything survives as well, because so far it doesn't look that great. Vanish!
Oh, was that like one of the only cards that would cleanly remove the whole board? I think so.
Possibly.
Oh my god.
That was
god.
Definitely a good card there.
Vanish is actually nuts.
Unless you hit your face, no.
Oh my god, that Yogg.
And you can play Yogg again.
Oh.
Unfortunately, you will burn a card.
That's right, though, isn't it? Vanish was like the only card that just removes everything off the board.
Well,
the Twisting only Nether wouldn't because of the
like
death
single
rattle.
Card because you could get the Twisting Nether into
yeah,
Doom,
you could. Yeah, like yeah. I mean, like you could just card. Flame Strike and stuff like that.
Yeah, but
the,
yeah,
the only single card, yeah.
Vanish definitely helps here.
Oh my god, these peddlers are not really doing too much work here for Orange.
So Orange will try to rebuild the board. Is he able to play?
I think you just put down your stickiest minion, so I imagine we're going to see the Possessed Villager as well. Just yeah. Get as much down that hopefully will stick, and then rely on something surviving combined with Direwolf to push additional damage.
And not enough minions to play Seekers. It's 5/5.
Yep.
Is he just going for the Seekers as 1/1?
Why Seeker and not Arcane normally?
Yeah, Anomaly should be fine as the Seeker.
Emperor Burn doesn't really matter at this point in the game.
So do we Yogg-Saron again?
Yeah, yeah, you just have to.
Yeah, you have to just make yourself in a better spot. And then
but Yogg has to put you in a better spot.
That's plus 2 armor.
Oh my.
Swipe is quite good. And that's 11 health only, so maybe you'll have an opportunity to actually win the game this time.
Oh. Where's the heal going?
That can heal.
There's a lot of minions. Oh my god, and it won the joust. That's a lot of healing.
That's
there's a lot of minions to hit, though.
Yeah, 1-1.
Oh,
one.
Okay, there we go.
Shield block is great. Yeah. You're fine with burning a card. That's definitely fine. You just want to have more health yourself.
Oh, it's lightning. Definitely not too terrible. Tough two of the minions, and there's what? 4, 6, there's 7 damage available. So there's 7. That needs to be found from Orange next turn as well.
So what do you do now? You can shape. Oh, there's
Void
the Voidwalker.
Yeah. Why not? Get a Web Spinner on the board.
Well, also Orange will have to actually, unless he has enough damage to win the next turn, he will have to deal with his Yogg-Saron.
Yeah, he's got a pretty easy answer though with the Direwolf as well.
What's the Frattle on the Flame Imp?
It's the Explorer's Hat.
Oh, okay, okay.
Defender Vargas, not too bad at all.
But it's still not enough. Tough situation, really. Yogg-Saron is flipping this game on its head.
Twice.
Yeah, most of the time, this is the best way for Druid to win. Just stall long enough.
Please don't say that.
Unfortunately, well, this is the combat card.
Reliance on Yogg.
In this matchup, I believe that is one of the best ways.
Yeah.
Specifically now, also, after the matchup changed and you play Malagas.
Okay, so Defender Vargas is really good here, just to put more power on the board in total. And just block out this Web Spinner. Not that the Web Spinner is going to cause too many issues, I imagine. But yeah, the Direwolf is probably going to be held in hand now. Just play the whole hand minus the Direwolf, because you want the on-demand instant damage. So that can hopefully come out for Orange next turn and really push. So he's still threatening a lot of damage, actually.
That's a really good board overall, and there is not enough damage for...
And there's no Yogg.
There is no Yogg. There is actually no Malagas. If you look at Malagas with the Living Roots and Moonfire, that would be it. But he just doesn't have it yet.
Is this as your Draken to swipe?
Might have to be, if you want to survive. You possibly can still survive, even like Azure Drake into Moonfire on the 3-2. Can give you some leverage. You definitely have to draw, I believe.
The Warlock would need 1 damage, I believe, if you just kill the 3-2 here.
So Azure Drake it is.
2 if you armor up, of course. But we can see that Orange just has that damage available in the form of the Direwolf. But how are you going to make the best play possible? Nourish is not a swipe.
It doesn't that work that well.
He can clear off more damage, right? He can actually Savage Roar.
Yeah, he can Savage Roar, run the spider into the 3-2, his own face into the 2-2, and Moonfire.
Well, he would Moonfire the 2-2, right?
Oh, you Moonfired it. Okay.
Because then he can still arm up and kill the 3-3, I guess.
Yeah, that's better. That's better, you're right. So we have how much damage on board left? This is 6-7 damage.
Oh, okay. He's not choosing to armor up. Okay.
So basically 9 damage with the Dire of Alpha, and we are at 11. So we need 2 more. That's not 2 more damage. He can still tap to try to find lethal.
I mean, these Doom Guards, they must be somewhere, right?
Yeah, definitely. You do play Doom Guards in the discard Warlock. And PO, we've seen double abusive, I think. Because the Villager is not...
Shake of the head from Orange there, and you know what? I can't blame him.
Not it,
this far into the game, you've not drawn a single Doom Guard is pretty horrendous overall.
And it's really tough right now, because you probably have to kill the 4-4.
Yeah, well, the benefit there is you can just throw the imp into that. It's a 4-1, the imp's done a good amount of work so far. And so Orange gets the hat, right?
Yeah, he gets the hat.
Okay.
He's the owner of the hat right now, I think.
Okay.
We'll see.
Pretty sure it is. Yeah.
It was on his minion.
Yeah. Okay, so the board can be cleared, and the hat's actually going to be useful in keeping a bit of this board alive. And yet again, everything's just going to get chucked down. Orange is going to go again. Be like, okay, here's a board. I'm going to kill you next turn because I will draw a Doom Guard. Please. And then going to see how Hoi chooses to respond. But Hoi has the craziest hand I've seen for a while as a druid. So there's a librarian, a starving buzzard.
Some random beasts.
Most importantly, an enchanted raven.
A raven again. So many ravens.
Exactly.
But yeah, with Fandral into Nourish, you are going to draw 3 cards, get 2 crystals.
He could buzzard draw with Raven. That's what I wanted to see.
So he's going up to 8, drawing 3 cards. He can actually draw lethal here. If you get like Malygos, Living Roots, and Moonfire.
Fel Rage is pretty nice.
Super good. Not only clearing a minion, but also getting that health. He also has Innervate with the Living Roots and Raven Idol. He might get something from the Raven Idol there. You just have to be careful not to overdraw, because it's going to...
Yeah, which is why we saw the Innervate come out first from Hoi. He isn't messing about. Ooh, the snap pick of the Argent Commander. Oh, you can Fel Rage Savagery as well to kill off another minion. This is why I love this Druid deck.
Yeah.
You have to, like... play with cards you're just not used to, and like really heavy on the decision making.
So 19 health, suddenly there is a Doomguard. This is not enough. This is 5, 7, 8, 13 damage.
It's 14.
14 damage?
Doomguard can. Oh no, never mind.
There is no Dire Wolf Alpha on the board.
I thought one of the cards was Dire Wolf Alpha. I'll take it all back, Nimsh. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Forgive me.
So now both our math is. Terrible.
Yeah. Okay, we're 1-1. We'll keep track for the rest of the day.
Okay. We'll try to improve, guys.
Yeah. Okay, this is looking rough, though, because... I mean, well, Doomguard's obviously the play, but you can't really afford to tap, because you die to swipe. I mean, you die to swipe anyway, right?
You die to swipe anyway, so...
I mean...
You just can't
win. Is there any reason to tap, though? I don't think there's any reason to tap.
If you would like to get a Voidwalker, but that's not enough, and... Druid takes it.
Yeah.
Even though Zoo had such a good run, double Yuxaron was enough to stop the Zoo and
this is
stop Orange there.
This is getting legitimately scary. Hoi is now what?
8-0. 8-0.
Druid. Oh my god. I wonder if he just closes his eyes and just picks whatever 2 classes he's got left for the, you know, after his first pick Druid. This is kind of nuts.
It was not an easy game, Raven.
No, the game was insane. I mean, and to be fair, the Yogg hitting the Vanish and then onto Yogg again, which was actually pretty decent the second time around. That did a lot of work.
Yeah, but I still do believe that Zoo is slightly favored in that matchup.
Yeah, I mean, we see the amount of pressure Hoi was under pretty much all game. And again, if Hoi had drawn a Doomguard at almost any earlier point in the game, it would have really closed it out very quickly, I feel. It's going to be Orange's Hunter as his last-ditch attempt. He has to 3-0 with this Hunter to take it. And Scavenging Hyena.
Yeah, Hyena is a nice tech. So he is playing more mid-rangey version of the Hunter, something different than Gaara was playing yesterday. Mm-hmm. Gaara was playing the Bronze.
A lot different from the Yasha.
A lot different, players. Yes. But still, I think this matchup is okay for the Druid because of the ramp. But looking at the hands, right now the hand of Orange is much better.
Yeah, I think it still feels a little bit slow. I kind of always like to try and get a one or two drop at least against the Druid to then, instead of thinking about, oh, well, of course I Wild Growth turn two, they have to start thinking about, oh, do I have to Wrath this or am I just going to start taking damage?
Cause you have a two drop.
Yeah, coin animal comp. You know what I mean. You know what I mean.
It looks
one
weird.
Or two drop names.
It's actually only missing the one drop here, right? Because you still have the perfect curve going into Animal Companion, Huntmaster or Infested Tauren, Wolf, and then Thundra, Rhino.
Yeah, okay. So while we're casting, we're going to play a game. Orange normally has full golden lists.
Yeah.
That is not a golden coin. What card has he not got golden?
Was Hyena golden?
I can't remember, is my honest answer. If I knew that, I would have challenged you and then I would have picked first.
No, I think it's golden. It's probably golden Hyena. Oh man, that's a good game.
Yeah, see. Well, think about it. I'll give you a few turns.
Do you have a card you want to pick first?
Not yet. Okay. Not yet. So, we see now that the Leok got picked off pretty easily. You know, Leok probably the worst. You know, you never really just want to drop a Leok on an empty board. And it's why Animal Companion is much more powerful when you have at least one other minion down as well, because you gain at least some benefit overall. But Misha, definitely a lot better,
decent.
Especially now with the we can see Fandral was available. And if that turn was a bit of a whiff, then just dropping Fandral requires quite a lot from the Hunter to just deal with off the cuff. So
yeah, but on the other hand, do you really want to drop the Fandral on turn four, even if there's Leok, because it can easily lose it with no value. Like right now, I think Fandral also has more value in the Druid list because of no Violet Teachers.
Yes.
So like Raven Idol works better, and a lot of spells just work better with Fandral. So if you are able to maybe ramp and just keep Fandral for the late game, it's a bit better. Like even last game, we've seen Hoi thinking, I think the first game actually they played, Hoi was thinking super hard to, if he wants to play Fandral versus Mage on turn four.
Mm-hmm. I've decided my card names.
You decided a card?
Yeah, and I don't know if the card's even in the deck, but Stranglethorn Tiger is my guess. That's what I'm going for. But now Orange has the choice between making dropping the Infested Wolf to make the clear a little bit more awkward to the tokens, but he's gone for the Houndmaster just to make a really big Misha. And even the Houndmaster itself does die to Wrath.
I have
again,
my card as well.
Okay.
Sorry to interrupt
it's
you.
It's fine. I'll let you off. But if the Wrath actually just kills off the Houndmaster, then suddenly the Druids turns back down to 4 mana, and you feel a lot better about it. Because obviously, as you said, we can see that Orange's Hunter is a very, very nice looking curve.
So my card is Barnes.
Oh, that's a good pick. I think Orange would have crafted Golden Barnes.
You think he has Golden Barnes?
It kind of looks like him, doesn't it? He's getting there with the hair.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Orange strikes me as the type who'll be like, this guy looks like me, I'll craft him in gold.
Well, if he doesn't have Golden Barnes, he probably loses.
Oh my god.
3-3 is so bad.
Is that one of, if not the worst poll you can do?
There is a 2-3, Murloc.
Okay. Ah, of course.
But 3-3
it's close.
It's not exciting at all.
It's very close. So the 3-3 is pretty horrible. You kind of rely on that portal in this position. Mm. One, yeah, you get the heal, but more importantly, you want a big chunky minion. Considering this can drop out a cairn, you know.
Not to mention, you are really behind.
Exactly. That's why you need something like huge to really
Sivana's
make an impact.
Cairn,
exactly. High main. Give the hunter a taste of his own medicine.
Even like wobbling runs.
Yeah, exactly. Just something that you can get some work done with. And now this is so scary playing against Hunter. They've got a board and they've just dropped Rhino. And now you
on
are
five. So
yeah,
on 36,
yeah, you
what
are
happens?
Scared to death of a high main next turn. Or even the problem is because Orange has access to what, 5 cards in hand, 6 on the draw, like even just other minions, you know
play
what I mean?
Boost,
like
play the frog.
Yeah, it just doesn't even have to be. High main's like worst case, but even just multiple, like, it's a huge toad fiery bat with charge. It's still kind of ridiculous.
Yeah, so this game seems to be really one-sided in Orange's favor, which means that Druid can actually lose here, but
you go Starfire, right?
Starfire into the 6-3?
No, I think
you have to kill the Rhino.
I think you have to. The value next turn is going to be insane.
You might be right. It's not something you kind of want to do because it's only two attack minion, but it's like more attack next
turn. Yeah, you have to kill it because next turn it's a huge problem. And then, well, how do you kill the turn after? And the turn after that? And then call the wild with full charge. It's a pretty strong card. So it's just, it was just forced into it. I think Orange got fortunate that he could deal with the Rhino that turn. It's still going to snowball out of control.
Raven, I'm afraid we're back to the original plan of still long enough to play Oxeron. Because that might be, like, this game is getting so one-sided that it might be...
There's an 8-5 Misha just slapped you in the face. You definitely need something something huge to happen here.
But even if... innervate Oxeron.
Okay. Moonfire or no Moonfire? That's my question. I think I would.
I would Moonfire.
He's not cast that many spells.
I would Moonfire Misha.
I would just Moonfire anything. Yeah, go face.
I would like Moonfire on Misha just if there's a Hellfire. It's like you can actually... It will be easier to finish Misha or something.
Gang up
on Misha.
Oh my god, an army of Misha.
That's a couple of taunts you're getting in your deck, but you still need to deal with this board.
Blizzard!
That deal with the board for one turn at least. Onshot. Perfect.
Oh my god, this
swipe is definitely good.
This Yogg.
That just clears. Oh, that clears even more.
Curse.
Two more damage.
I mean,
that wasn't that many spells, but the spells were super good.
Orange, head in hand. Don't blame him. That was pretty horrible.
Well, I will not blame him, especially because normally Yogg-Saron should be played on turn 10, not turn 8, so that innervate was key and even. Wow. He still has a chance, though.
Is this actually bow kill command face?
That's six damage to the face. You leave your opponent at 5. Next turn, you have Huffer plus
and
the weapon.
And the bow.
So
there's no
damage.
There's literally like what Ancient of War that could come out that would stop you, but you need to do something to win this game at this point, right? You've just had your massive board completely wiped. And does it? Oh, okay. So I mean, I suppose the wolf is difficult to deal with. You still have a potential 5 damage kill command next turn.
Yeah.
Or he has kill command into hero power, so maybe this is better, actually.
Well, your plan is basically to just, like, chain Call of the Wilds, in a way. But then Hoi needs to find a way to not only survive, but to kill his opponent as well. So Feral Rage is a great card to get. With Fundrel, he will be able to combine it and have 8 health, so go up to 16. Go face with Yogg and go face with Feral Rage. That sounds pretty good. Is there anything else you might want to do instead? Do you want to maybe just go Feral Rage, get the health, play Arcane Giant to have more leverage on board? That's 4-7 mana. You can even hero power there as well. Just for one, deal 8 damage to face. And then your opponent has to... It will be really tough to deal 16 damage in one turn.
Yeah, I think I like the Arcane Giant a bit better. Because also, we've not seen any traps from Orange, right? And Trapless Hunter is you know, there's multiple variants of Trapless Hunter that's going around. That's quite a strong deck at the moment. So you're not afraid of, like, the frustrating freezing trap scenario where there's just the Arcane Giant on the board. So I actually really like this. Fandral is actually just kill commandable.
Yeah.
So it's just not a problem. Or Huffer if this is going to be a Call of the Wild turn. So it can be dealt with. Whereas the Arcane Giant requires much more resources to deal with here, and even the curse in the extra 2 damage.
It does deal damage, and the damage stacks up. There's Living Roots in the hand, so you know if Malagus gets picked up, if one of those minions survives. Also, this situation makes Snake Trap a bit better, because right now you kind of want to kill Yogg-Saron, so you maybe want to attack. You still don't know what the trap is specifically. You've played the wolf and a weapon. So this can still be Cut Trick. This is not Bird Trap. This is not Explosive Trap. It can still be Freezing Trap. So Freezing, Snake, Cut Trick, Dart, and Misdirection. No, Misdirection not really because you've attacked with the weapon. So only those 4, I believe.
Yeah, I think you have to kill the 7-3. Worst case, it's Snake. And then he has 3-1-1s. Is that going to potentially lose you the game over leaving Yogg up? Like, I don't think so. And your next turn is almost always... Depending on health value of the druid, of course, either the kill command to win the game or the second Call of the Wild to put up an additional turn.
So Orange will be down to 10 health with Cursed next turn, which means Hoi needs to find a way to deal 10 damage.
And it means Hoi has to trade. Orange has to trade because the 3 snakes plus hero power will go into Misha, the hit plus the 2 damage.
Does swipe actually win the game? Oh, if he gets swipe from Azrajic, that he definitely wins the game. If he gets Wrath, he wins the game.
No, he has one, right? He can live in Roots, trade one, do 10 damage with Hero Power, and two damage from the curse.
That's it. That's it. You're right. I forgot about the snakes, dude.
Okay. The snakes were an issue, but then again, Yogg would cause the same issue if you left it up. So it's not like it was a problem on Orange's side either way. He had to do what he did. And wow, Hoi 3-0s with Druid off the back of...
Yogg-Saron.
To be honest, a pretty insane Yogg in the end of that.
And three times, actually.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, Hoi was playing the matches incredibly well, I believe. I think he was playing it, you know, all his plays we agreed with. Played really well, but you can't really dispute that those Yoggs pretty much carried the series there.
Lothar, what did you think about...
his face is telling us what he thinks about this.
You know, I'm a pretty big advocate on Inner Fate, and now also on Yogg, and now we have seen him both in one turn.
Yogg and Inner Fate.
I don't think I have seen a more impactful Yogg in this tournament than this one. It was played
Which
on
one? Because we have three. We had three.
You mean the last one.
Okay,
we had three in
First
two
of
games.
All, there was no way for Hoi to make a comeback with any other card in his deck.
Yeah, no combination of cards that can actually deal
in
with
the
that.
Game.
He was always getting wrecked on the next turn and stacking up damage.
Honestly, depends like what cards he has in hand, because if he gets like Malaga's Moonfire Living Roots, I think he
will probably be able to review
he
the
didn't
game
have now. Mana for that.
You're right, because he was 8 mana.
So here we go, unfortunately the highlights being the Yogg turns, because these are the turns that were the most impactful in the games. So.
Well, honestly guys, it's this like format is complicated, and the guys have the strategies, picks and bans, and then they position themselves in the situation where Yogg is a comeback card. It's not like you basically always try to play till Yogg and then win with Yogg. It is there is some randomness involved in the card, so you take the risk of playing the card. In some situations...
No, I don't think so. You don't take any risk by playing Yogg. You can need to play the card because that's how the metagame looks.
Yeah, well, the card's extremely powerful, and it allows you to come back into games that on paper you shouldn't be allowed to come back on. And we see in the first one there is Hoi, the Yogg stayed alive and was Divine Shielded as well, so gave him even more options. Did see that this game was actually ended by Malygos, which is something that Hoi did a lot. Yes, I think yesterday on his last series, every single game
every
was Malygos
first. Malygos.
And it was just—it's so cool to watch. Just Malygos do like quite ridiculous sums of damage, and this is the vanish. And I was saying during this cast, like, there's very few like singular clears that can deal with this board. And look, you know, like Hoi's on 7, right? So you know that's a low amount of damage if you leave any minions up. But bang, there we go. Vanish straight everything back into the hand.
Doomguard could actually finish the game.
Blizzard would be very impactful as well on this board, because then it makes the minions practically useless for one turn, and you still have your minions on board. And an example, those three web spinners, when trading or just dealing damage, would have been very impactful, right?
Yeah, but even with the there would have been a 1/1 possessed villager token. So you imagine things like power for when we do that.
Yeah,
you know
can
what
happen.
I mean. So it's just the completely removing the board was insane.
Yep.
And
sure.
Now we see the Hunter game where you know Orange was pretty much dominating early on, and Yogg did its thing, I guess, and cleared everything up and allowed Hoi to get back into the game and finish it up.
When you think about Swipe, is one of the best cards from Yogg, because it's always...
You can't swipe your own minions,
yes,
right?
It's always on your opponent's minions or on his face, so you're guaranteed to deal an AoE damage.
Yeah, and look, the curse...
Curse of Rafam deals like
six damage.
Yeah.
Six damage from Curse of Rafam for the lethal, which is also crazy. When you think about it, it's basically like a hero power from Hunter for 3 turns, for 0 mana.
Yeah.
For zero mana.
We have
Hoi
with
here.
Us.
Hey,
congrats, man.
Thank you.
So how did it go for you? Can you tell us something about the games?
Yeah.
What was your thought process on the first, especially on the first one and the second one?
Yeah, I've been praying a lot to Yogg lately, and it works out. Yeah, the Yogg was really, really brutal in this series. Mm-hmm. In the
second and third game, right?
What was the first game even?
First game was against the mage.
But then I got a good curve and could ramp out, and then like I played minion on turn 4, he had to remove it. And then I played Imbra on turn 6, he had to remove it. That was also the reason for me to play Fendril on turn 4. Even though I have Red Hand, it's like it's really
unlikely that he also have a removal for Emperor next turn then? Because I know he has to remove the Defender.
Because he was on like the back foot constantly.
Yeah, exactly.
He
has to remove.
Always playing a minion, and he minion. Always had to do something.
It was really, really hard for him to get back in that game.
This is the like a trademark for current Druid. Every single minion presents a big threat enough that your opponent needs to remove it. Otherwise, you just snowball, right? You have Vandrel. Even an Azure Druid presents a huge threat because you have so much spells.
But the thing about this deck is it doesn't have that many minions, so you also have to like you need damage from the minion, especially against control matchup as control warrior. You can't just lose the minions because you can only rely on Malygus first.
Yeah, but exactly. Against, but against limited damage.
Yeah, but against Aggro it doesn't matter. You just have to survive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, correct. Well, well played. You're 9-0.
Yeah, with the
Druid. That's kind of ridiculous when you think about right?
But I still think like I know that the last game was really, really close, but like, I feel like he could, instead of trading from a 3-3, he could have dealt 6 damage small face.
That is definitely.
So it's like, it looks way more close in the end, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, the trading with this 6-6 to a 3-3, when you're playing against a druid, I think the only thing that could have hurt him was a mulch, and I don't think you're playing
no,
the mulch.
No, I'm not
right?
playing mulch.
Yeah, so.
And you know the decks, because you've got all the...
You can still play around Raven Idol much, you know, against.
Oh yeah, okay, Raven Idol shining exists. But this is 6 damage lost in the process, right? And he was pretty close to killing you.
Yeah, but yeah, I got really lucky. Like, Innovate Yuck and then Feral Rage next turn. And I already played one Feral Rage in turn 3 against this enemy companion, so I needed exactly those cards.
So how with the Bouncing Picks, because, well, you're rocking with Druid, obviously, but do you feel like with Bouncing Picks you're winning overall? Like, are you happy with the rest of the decks you are getting?
Owens made a really, really good ban in this game, actually. He banned my priest in the last bans because it was really, really good against the sacred line, so all this sacred decks, so I was really surprised about that. Mm-hmm. So actually 41 the banning pick in this game.
Okay.
Alright.
Okay, sounds good. Anyway, this is you're advancing to the next stage.
Yes.
You're still in the winner's bracket, so you have an easy way, let's say like that.
Hopefully.
Hopefully for the grand final, right? Because then you have the ultimate advantage of having 2 matches to be played. If you
I'm going to play a Super JDA next, Ryan?
I don't think so.
We'll wait for confirmation.
Because I can't remember the bracket. But we'll cut to a short break, and we'll prepare for the next match, which will be Xyxo versus Tessin. So don't go anywhere. This is PGL Tavern.